more shipping tank testing at Massey's, new OLM construction stands at Sanchez, footings finally laid in the newly acquired plot of land near the Star Factory at the build site, and crane reconfiguration at the launch site. BJ with you this week, and welcome to RGV Aerial Photography's Starbase Flyover Update 57. We'll cover these exciting developments and more with this week's photos from Starbase, Texas. As usual, we'll be relying on our trusty pilot, Fred, seen here in this onboard view from inside the cockpit of the Cessna 172. These flights are only possible with the cooperation and dedication of pilots like Fred. As usual, we'll start our test over at the Massey's Rocket Testing Facility. Here's a labeled map to get you familiar with the layout of the site. Thanks to Procky for creating these. Beginning at the flame trench, we can see Ship 31 after it was transported to the site on Friday, September 6th. It has conducted two tests on the 8th and 14th of September. It is unclear what the objectives of these tests were, but neither resulted in the expected static fire. Taking a look at the structural test stand, we can see piston attachment to the stand has taken place with the five pistons attached from the cap to the five legs of the stand. An additional piston has also been attached between the upper aft flap hinge point and the new horizontal stand beam, as well as a second one that attaches to the quick disconnect panel. Since the last flyover, Test Tank 16 has tested three times on the 6th, 10th, and 13th of September. Around the backside of the test stand, we can also see that the stairwell platforms and staircases are complete to the top of the current structure. Crew have also resumed work on the fourth level of the structure to the rear. At the front of the site, the parking lot concrete has extended to the property boundary. Also in the parking lot near the old can crusher base, a load spreader can be seen that has arrived recently. Now, let's move over to the Sanchez site. Here's this week's map to get yourself orientated. Sanchez wasn't packed with activity this week, but some significant developments took place. Let's start our tour at the speculated OLM-2 construction area. Four new pedestals have been delivered over the past couple of weeks. These were staged to the side of the embeds ahead of placement. We could have even more items getting delivered real soon ahead of the construction of this structure, so keep an eye out on this development. Near Highway 4, the circular jig previously seen here has been moved into the Star Factory. Moving closer to the storage tent, a new tank with ports arrived, and after the flyover, one more was delivered to the site. Nearby, the components for two more of these stands used here can be seen, which may mean we will see another one delivered. These look pretty much like the well-known hippos or subcoolers used for LOX and methane at the launch site, but as these are larger than those, they might be related to the methane recovery system for Pad B. That system is used to recondense methane coming from boil-off during the propellant load sequence and from the detanking process. Seeing this kind of progress ahead of getting Pad B ready for use is fantastic. Let's see how this develops in the next couple of weeks. More cleanup work has taken place at the storage area and is nearly free of all the items formerly stored on the shelving in this area. At the Rocket Garden, one of the booster transport adapters has been fitted to an SPMT with the other on the ground nearby. Counterweights have been staged here as well. Could this be to move Booster 12 out of Mega Bay 1 for storage, like Ship 30? Or even to move Booster 13 to the OLM for a static fire? Let us know what you think in the comments below. At the scrapyard, Booster 4 continues its scrapping process with more engines getting removed and staged ahead of the cutting torch work. Some of these engines appear to have shielding on them, indicating that they could be the center engines that were moved from Ship 26. Finally, the parking garage continues to be clad with an underlay product and a finishing layer. Now let's take a look at the build site. Refer to this labeled map of the build site as we move our way around the site. First off, we see holes in Mega Bay 2's cladding for additional vents, with ductwork being installed. Inside the bay, Lab Padre's Rover 1 caught Ship 33's aft flaps being installed on September 15th. As far as we know, these aft flaps feature the exact same design as Block 1 ships, with only the forward flaps having a thinner and smaller design. In front of Mega Bay 1, we see a press pipe installation jig, which will be used for autogenous pressurization. Inside the bay, Booster 15 is still in two parts, and as always, Boosters 12, 13, and 14 are in the back three stands. These haven't been moved for over a month. The high bay remains empty since Ship 31 was moved to Massey's back on the 6th. At the Star Factory, the cutout for the main entrance facing the high bay is just about complete, as seen in this ground shot by Starbase Surfer. Now looking next to Tent 4, the last of these transformers is being installed. At the area between the office building and Star Factory, more footings have appeared along with more steel beams. We can expect this space to be built up within the coming weeks. Cladding installation is finishing up on the north-facing segment of the office building. On the roof, insulation sheets are being installed. Zooming out, one part of the Star Factory's roof has become considerably white compared to the rest of the roof after a round of pressure washing. Along Highway 4, earthworks seem to suggest that this will be a nature strip with fresh planted palms and shrubbery against the building. Our last stop at the build site will be at the Village Recreation Center, where work continues on what could be possibly two pools and a hot tub. With that, let's check in at the launch site. Let's first look at this week's labeled map. Beginning at Pad B construction, the installation of sheet piles has been completed. The added wall to the southwest has extended toward the northwest end of the trench and turned to the corner towards the tower. After about a week of jet grouting sitting idle, progress has continued along the completed sheet piles. Shifting to Tower 2, concrete trucks are offloading into the pump used for filling the tower legs. Looking up the tower, we can see the concrete pipe is connected at the Module 3 fill ports, indicating Module 2 is currently being filled. Rising another two modules, the carriage rail segments are being prepared at the bottom of Module 5 for installation. Laying down, the CC8800-1 appears to be reconfigured for the rest of its job. The lift lines for the hook block have been run, and all that we are waiting for is to reeve the hook block and raise the boom for use. At the new concrete bunker, work is a little submerged following the recent heavy rains. The trench to the south is filled with water, including the trench shoring still in place. To the north, it appears the conduit runs from the bunker to the existing vaults near the SpaceX sign have been completed, as the large trench seen during the August 30th flyover have been backfilled most of the way back to the bunker. Following the relocation of Starhopper this week, we can see it at its new location across the highway. With no noticeable activity at the tank farm, let's look at Pad A. Looking first to the OLM, preparations for the next flight continue to wind down. This week, the top surfaces of the launch ring have received new paint, including the top of the Raptor quick disconnect hoods and retraction linkages. All that remains to be painted is a small section near the southern access hatch. The booster quick disconnect hood has also been painted black. Inside the launch ring, we can also see that the scaffolding assembled on the dance floor for work on the hold-down clamps and Raptor quick disconnects is being removed. The chopsticks still appear to be one of the main focal points of Pad A work. The catch rails, bumpers, shift lift pins, and lift stabilizer arms all seem to have finished up work, while a swarm of boom lifts have descended on the structural reinforcements of the areas closest to the hinge points. In this ground image, courtesy of Sean Gisler, we can see the areas stripped of paint in preparation of the newest bars being added. Two of them are visible in this image, extending below where each of the travel stops used to be. The arms of the chopstick carriage are also seeing some attention, though it is less clear what systems are being worked on. Raising up the tower, scaffolding seen recently has greatly decreased. Left visible, we can see the added structural reinforcements to both the center junctions and the leg connections to possibly resist some of the flexing seen during the most recent chopstick closing tests. And that's it for episode 57 of Starbase Flyover Update. Thank you for choosing to fly with RGV Aerial Photography, and I hope you all enjoyed the flight. If you like what you saw today, please leave a thumbs up and subscribe for more episodes and content so you don't miss out on the new videos each week. I'd like to also give a shout out to our Patreon members who offer insights from their individual areas of expertise during the show and tell sessions following each flyover. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you next week from 10,500 feet.